Ladies and gentlemen, if we can have your attention for just a minute. Momentarily, we're going to begin our celebration of life for Miss Karen and this worship service this morning. If you have a cell phone or digital device, if you could please place it on silent or off mode for the duration of the service in respect for the service, that'd be great. And we'll begin momentarily. Thank you.
Good morning. I don't need a microphone, do I? You can hear me okay in the back rows? You hear me?
On the microphone?
Can you hear me?
I can hear you. We couldn't hear
him. How about over there? Can you hear me okay? All right. My name's Travis. Like y'all didn't know. This morning we're going to have the funeral service, celebration of the life of my dear wife, Karen. That's why you're here. You loved her, she loved you. Everything we're going to do this morning, except one, is something that Karen requested for her funeral. And the one thing is for me to speak. I'm not going to preach, but Brother Winfred Baker was supposed to do this part, but he is in Arizona preaching a revival and cannot be here. So I know what Karen wanted, and I'm going to try and honor her the best I can with that. And before we do anything else, I'm going to ask you to all stand. And Brother Sidney Davis, would you lead us in prayer, please?
Father, we're thankful that we can look up to you at this time and rejoice in your great salvation, your grace, your mercy, your love, and for the life of Karen. We thank you for her faith in you, her faithfulness, her family. We pray for the family today. We have this service, this recognition of her divine service to you and celebration of her ongoing. And we realize that one day we shall go that path also. And until that time, may we do what we can to reach others for the Lord Jesus Christ and give them a message of salvation. Ask you to accept our thanks for all the good things you do for us. In the name of Christ we pray.
Amen.
You may be seated. If you did not pick up one of these little cards with the picture of Karen on the front, if you would raise your hand, the pallbearers will give you one. Okay. There'll be some up here also, Bimmy. Just keep your hand up for a few minutes. There's a song on the back. This Karen's favorite song. We'll be singing that a little bit later. So we want to make sure that you have one of these cards. Okay? So if you don't mind, keep your hand up until you get it. Somebody will bring you one. The first thing Karen asked for was for our daughter Fallon to sing. You want me to tell them the song? You're going to tell them? You'll tell them. So Fallon's going to come down and sing, and she asked Nathan to play for her. And so here they are.
Good morning. Thank you guys all for being here. Before I sing, I found this journal a couple weeks ago, and it was started in 2004 by my mom, and it was all about what she wanted for this day. So I just thought I'd read a little bit from that. It says, "My funeral. I know people will be sad, but I really hope that there can be some sense of joy, because I know I will be happy where I am. I just can't wait sometimes when I think about it. It sure puts things into perspective. What have I done so well in my life that at my death people will miss? If you are reading this, I am most likely already gone. I am in the arms of Jesus. The waiting is over. How exciting! I get chills just thinking about it, even now. I would say don't grieve for me, but I know that it's hard not to. But I'm better off now, and my pain and suffering is gone. She wrote that in 2004, long before cancer. And she says, God is very real now. Think about it. It's going to be unbelievable.
Amen.
My mom lived a life for Jesus, and she asked me, maybe around the time that this journal was written, it was definitely many years ago, she asked me to sing this song by one of her favorite artists, Evie, called Live for Jesus.
Thank you, Fallon. I appreciate that. For Wade. I'm looking for Wade. Wade's going to come and lead us in a word of prayer. Wade is our nephew by marriage. Good friend. Great nephew. Servant of God. Thank you, Wade.
Amen. Let's pray. Father, Father in heaven, we come to before you now and we just thank you for Karen's life. We thank you for the love that she had for her kids and her grandkids. We thank you for the joy that she showed in every smile that she smiled. And Father, we thank you that she was always in love with you. Father, we thank you for the relationship that she had with her dear husband, for her willingness to follow him and follow your will to the ends of the earth and back, for the faithfulness that she carried out her duties as a wife and a mother and a grandmother and a pastor's wife and a missionary's wife. And Father, we thank you for the lives that she touched, for the ways that you used her. Father, I thank you for all the stories that I heard from our friends in the Philippines about what a wonderful, wonderful woman Miss Karen was. Thank you for impacting their lives. Thank you for using her to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. Father, we now rejoice that she is with you. Father, we just thank you so much that her suffering is over and that her time has just begun sitting at your feet and worshiping with the beautiful voice that she had. Father, we look forward to seeing her again someday and worshiping together with her someday in heaven with you. And so, Father, as we go through this time of remembering, I just pray, Father, that we will celebrate her life and that we will celebrate all that she loved. And Father, we thank you for the salvation that she has through Jesus Christ, and that we have the hope of being able to see her again one day. We pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Some of you can remember back when churches didn't have air conditioning. Anybody remember that?
Yes.
What did funeral homes do? They gave you fans. Where's Jack? I don't know where Jack is, but you see Jack, you remind him. Funeral homes used to give fans. Too many of these, you need them, amen? Trey is going to come and give a eulogy for his mom. I'm sorry. Okay, congregational hymn first. I forgot my program. He's got his. On the back of your little card is a song that Karen's favorite song. When she listed songs she wanted to sing, when she talked to me about it, this was always at the top of the list.
All right, so any of you that would like to stand with us and sing, you can. You don't have to. You can sit and sing with us. And let's sing Karen's favorite song. My Savior, first of all.
Are there any more cards?
When my life work is ended and the cross on swelling tide, when the bright glorious morning I shall see, I shall know my Redeemer when I reach the other side, and his smile will be the first to welcome me. I shall know.
Mansion in the sky.
I shall know.
People in California, but we met one particular guy who was special in many, many ways. I led him to the Lord. I spent a year teaching him the Bible, helping him to grow. He became a pastor, a minister. He's a musician. He's a hip-hop guy. I don't like hip-hop, but I like Lamar. Okay? And thankfully, he's not singing hip-hop this morning. I don't think. He may be down in hip-hop, and if he does, y'all just ignore it. And he'll get to, remember, he's from California. He's not from Louisiana. I know some of y'all like hip-hop, too, I'm sure. But anyway, Lamar, Karen gave Lamar a soundtrack many years ago and asked him to learn it and sing it, and he did. And about 3 weeks ago, she said, I wish I could hear Lamar sing. And I called him and told him, and he started singing the song. And when he finished, we hung up, and she said, I wish Lamar could sing at my funeral. But I called him right back, and he said, I'll be here. So he's here. Lamar, say whatever you like.
I don't really do hip hop.
Oh, you don't?
So you guys are okay. You guys are okay. Well, I just flew in, like you said, from San Diego. I wasn't gonna miss this for anything. Some of your faces are very familiar, and some of you guys were snotty nosed kids when I first met you. Oh, yeah, Joy. But I guess I was a snotty-nosed kid when you first met me. I was 19, and the circumstances for me coming to the Lord were pretty graphic. Literally a gun to my head and somebody pulling the trigger and me surviving. And God said, I have a family I'd like you to meet, the Moores. So I have been adopted as the Moore from the South, deep South. But like you said, Karen was the very first person to even show me how to lead worship. And the very first song I ever learned is the one I'm about to do, and hopefully I get it right, because I've had about 20 years to get it, to work on it. But it's such a great depiction of, I could just imagine Karen walking into the gates of heaven. And when she first showed me the song, I was nervous because it was from the Brooklyn Tabernacle. And I'm like, ooh, that's not easy. But then I heard it and the words of it, and I almost feel like it was ordained and very prophetic of her that she would teach me this song and that I would be here 20, 24 years later, to be able to sing it for her. More than anything, I hope that at the end of the day that you leave here knowing that there's a God that loves you.
Amen.
This was a beautiful woman, and I even told my pastor, he's always going to be my pastor, that you chose well, but God ordained you for something beautiful, and you have a beautiful family, and this is a beautiful church, and I'm just honored that you guys would have me here.
Amen.
So, no hip-hop, but I'm going to give it a go. Is that okay?
Is it on Bluetooth?
dream of a city called glory, so bright and so fair. When I enter the gates, I cried, holy, for the angels all met me there. They carried me from mansion to mansion and door. The sights I saw but when I entered, I said I want to see Jesus, the bowed on my knees and cried, holy, I cried, holy, holy, I clapped my hands and sang, the gates of that city. Thank you.
oldest son, Travis Earl Moore II, better known as Trey, is going to give the eulogy for his mom. Trey.
I don't know how I'm going to follow that, though. Amen. Wow. Don't worry, I'm not going to preach.
Amen.
I don't think I could if I wanted to. Give me a moment here to collect my emotions and whatnot. I really don't know what to say. I mean, I know I have a lot of things that I want to say at this point. One word that just comes to my mind is wow. I'll explain that in a minute. I want to, on behalf of my dad, my mom, on behalf of my brother, my sisters, and our families, and mama's family, Serena and Lynette, I just want to say thank you to all of you for coming out here today. For those of you who have sung or will be singing, buddy, the mic. Maybe a little bit? All right. How's that? Is that better? Yeah. Is it on? Is it working?
There you go.
All right. Just want to say thank you for all of you for coming out today on behalf of our family. But not only that, I know many of you, most of you, if not all of you, and many more people who could not make it here today, have been there for my mom and dad to support us, to support our family through prayer, through food, through all kinds of many ways, most of which I probably don't know. From the bottom of my heart, on behalf of my family, I want to say thank you so much. And God bless you. May God bless you all for the service that you've rendered to our family. I'd also like to take a moment to recognize Brother Dundoy, officially known as Commander Biadog, United States Navy, who will be delivering the official message in just a few moments. Brother, you've been a kind friend to our family for so many years, since before I was born, along with this Billy and many others. And I just want to thank you, brother, for your service to our family, for your service to our country.
Amen.
I believe he's getting ready to retire after nearly 30 years. Amen, brother? Amen. Thank you, brother. Thank you. Brother Dundoy, I just want to say I'm glad you were delivering the message this morning. Really am, because I'm having trouble getting through this, as you can tell. I don't know. I'm glad it's you and not me, is what I'm going to say, brother. Just thank you for that. When I said wow earlier, it's because I realized that I don't, and neither does Brother Dundoy, nobody has to preach Mama's funeral today. Because she's preached it herself.
Amen.
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 And when I think of that legacy, when I think of that blessing, I'm just amazed. One of my favorite memories of Mama is actually a collection of memories, many memories over many years. And I'm proud to say that I've got a very similar memory of my dad. And as I would get up in the mornings to get ready for school as a kid, or to get up in the middle of the morning or at noon as a teenager during the summer, there was almost always evidence that Mama and Daddy had spent time with Jesus that morning.
Amen.
Dad's Bible was always on his desk, sometimes with his commentaries and concordances and other books. sometimes just a notepad, or in later years, his computer. Mama's Bible was always on the coffee table, on the kitchen table, on the end table, on the couch, sometimes on her bed. Her Bible never got dusty. Mom and Daddy were people who loved the Word of God and who knew the Word of God.
Amen.
And over the last several years, I've been very thankful for that and for the love of the Word that they tried to pass on to me and to my siblings. And a few scriptures have really stood out to me and really ministered to my heart. And I'd like to share a few of those with you, if I may. The book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 7, verse 1. A good name is better than a good ointment. The day of one's death is better than the day of one's birth. It is better to go to a house of mourning than to a house of feasting, because that is the end of every man, and the living takes it to heart. Sorrow is better than laughter, for when a face is sad, a heart may be happy. The mind of the wise is in the house of mourning, while the mind of fools is in the house of pleasure. Many years ago, when I first read and pondered on these scriptures, I thought they were strange. And I wasn't sure I agreed with them at first, although I knew, being the Word of God, it must be right somehow. But today I understand these words, for although my face is sad, my heart is happy for my mama.
Amen.
I think a lot of us understand that now, if we didn't already. But there's wisdom here also, in that times like this are meant to remind us of what's truly important in life. Our faith in Jesus Christ, number one, our family, our friends, our fellowship with God's people, the church. And that's why the mind of the wise, I believe, takes these things to heart in times like this. And I hope that this day will cause us to reevaluate and, if necessary, make the changes necessary to adjust our walk with Jesus. Because I know that's what Mama would have wanted. Because I know that's what Mama did. Mama had a secret. Not really a secret, I guess, but she knew that she didn't have to wait until her feet were touching streets of gold to actually walk with Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
She knew she didn't have to wait for that. And growing up with her, I saw how she walked with Jesus to the best of her ability. For as long as I knew her, at least, and I know before that. Psalm 116, verse 12. What shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits toward me? I shall lift up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I shall pay my vows to the Lord. Oh, may it be in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his godly ones. O Lord, surely I am thy servant, the son of thy handmaid. Thou hast loosed my bonds. To thee I shall offer a sacrifice of thanksgiving and call upon the name of the Lord. I shall pay my vows to the Lord. Oh, may it be in the presence of all his people, in the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of you, O Jerusalem. Hallelujah. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So much more I want to say. It's all kind of jumbled up in my mind right now. So, I'm so proud to be her son.
Yeah.
Not only did Mama walk with the Lord and know the Lord and love the Lord, but she tried to spread that love and her faith everywhere she went, through her music, through her character, through her actions, through her love through her service in the church and through her motherhood and her loving devotion to my dad. Mm-hmm. And I believe Mom would want us to know that being a Christian, you know, I've heard people say over the years that Christianity is a relationship. And I've heard some people go so far as to say that it's not a religion. I believe that it's both. James tells us that pure and undefiled religion is to visit orphans and widows, fatherless and the widows in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by this ungodly world. In Christianity, faith in Jesus Christ is not just a relationship, not just a religion, but it's the only religion that puts man in a right relationship with Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen.
There are people who want religion only. In Jesus' day, they were called Pharisees. And their religion caused them to be arrogant and sometimes hateful and spiteful to those who were not as religious as they were. In modern times, we see the trend where people want all the benefits of Christianity without the commitment. They want the hope of heaven, but they don't want to take up their cross. But I believe the Bible teaches us both. God is our master. Jesus is our master, our Savior, and our Lord. Mama knew that. Mama served Jesus. And Mama loved Jesus. Yeah. Mama knew that her sins, although I can't think of what they were, my daughters have said, she was just so pure of heart, it seems. But Mama was a human being, and she needed Jesus just as much as anybody.
Amen.
And she knew that. And she loved Jesus for that very reason. And I believe Mama would want us to feel the same way. To know that it's worth it to take up your cross and follow Jesus. 1st and 2nd Peter. Peter talks a lot about suffering as a Christian. The path of following Jesus and taking up your cross is not always an easy one. Mama would know, would have us know today that it's definitely worth it. And I believe she would have me encourage all of us today to remember that, to recommit our hearts if necessary, and to follow Jesus with all our heart and mind and soul as she tried to do with every fiber of her being. In closing, I would also like to share with you a song, although I'm not going to try to sing this morning. When Mama was first diagnosed, I came across this song on Christian radio, Spotify somewhere. Very talented young Christian artist by the name of Carrie Jobe has a wonderful rendition of it. I'm just going to read you the words of the original hymn, because this hymn has been there, has helped me. God has used this hymn to heal my heart and to prepare my heart for this day. Get it big enough where I can read it on my phone here. Be still, my soul. The Lord is on thy side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. Leave to thy God to order and provide. In every change, he, faithful, will remain. Be still, my soul. Thy best, thy heavenly friend through thorny ways leads to a joyful end. Be still, my soul. Thy God doth undertake to guide the future as he has the past. Thy hope, thy confidence, let nothing shake. All now mysterious shall be bright at last. Be still, my soul. The waves and winds still know his voice who ruled them while he dwelt below. Be still, my soul. When dearest friends depart, amen. And all is darkened in the veil of tears, then shalt thou better know his love, his heart, who comes to soothe thy sorrow and thy fears. Be still, my soul, thy Jesus can repay from his own fullness all he takes away. Be still, my soul, the hour is hastening on when we shall forever be with the Lord. When disappointment, grief, and fear are gone, sorrow forgot, and love's purest joys restored. Be still, my soul, when change and tears are past, all safe and blessed, we shall meet at last. Be still, my soul. Begin the song of praise. Be still, my soul. Begin the song of praise on earth, believing to the Lord on high. Acknowledge him in all thy words and ways. So shall he view thee with a well-pleased eye. Be still, my soul. The Son of Life divine, through passing clouds, shall but more brightly shine.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Our family went to New Song Community Church. We liked it. And we stayed for a while. Their music director was Mr. Free Grafton.
Woo!
Woo! But we love New Song. There's so much good about it. I told Pastor Hal Seed and many others that of all the people I've ever worshipped with, who led worship, Free Grafton's the greatest I'd ever experienced. Every time Free led worship, I worshiped. I was brought to the throne of God like none other. Now, to be honest, Nathan's my favorite worship leader, but he's my son. And he's almost as good as Free, probably. Maybe better, I don't know, but... When Karen journaled about her funeral, the second person she named that she wanted to sing was Free Grafton. I'll tell you the first one later. But Free's going to sing a song that had two verses until Karen saw it, and she wrote a third verse.
Amen.
And Free's going to sing.
My life was easy.
have a question in Karen's mind who she wanted to preach her funeral. Commander Manuel Viedo Jr., we have known since he was a teenager.
Amen.
The third day, Karen and I were in the Philippines as missionaries. We went to Talisay High School, and I was given an opportunity to preach. And one of the young people in that meeting that day was Commander Viedo. Nobody called him Commander Viedo then. They called him Dundoy. Everybody say Dundoy.
Dundoy.
Say it right now. Dundoy.
Dundoy.
And so Dundoy got saved that day and became, well, I told our church Sunday, of all the, I got lots of friends. I know that. I got a lot of people I could call you up, tell you I want to go eat, I want to go talk, I want to do whatever, and you would be there. I know that. But my BFFest of all is Dundoy.
Amen.
Commander Viedo.
Amen.
And he's a chaplain in the U.S. Navy. He came to America to go to college, and I was against it. I thought he should have stayed in the Philippines because he has such a remarkable ability to share the gospel and preach. And, I thought we need him in the Philippines more than we need him here. But he came anyhow. I knew what would happen. He'd get over here and find a pretty young American girl and get married, and that's what happened. But you know, I think God had a better plan than me.
Amen.
I know he did.
Amen.
And he brought him here, and he went to college, got a degree, went to another college, got another degree, went to a seminary, got another degree. He got more degrees than a thermometer right now. But anyway, he has been my best friend and one of Karen's best friends down through the years. He retires on Friday. I was supposed to go to his retirement ceremony. When he swore in to be a Navy chaplain, I was there when he swore in. I was there when he saved. I was there when he was baptized. I was there when he surrendered to preach. I guess, were you ordained in the Philippines? I was there then, I guess. Oh, you here? Well, I wasn't there. Forget that. But then I was there when he joined the Navy, and I wanted to be there when he got out, but I won't be able to because, you know, other commitments. So anyway, he understands that, but he was able to come here today, and I thank you, Doy. I call him Doy. Y'all call him Dundoy. I call him Doy. Well, he's my BFF. Come on.
Pastor Travis, Jerry MacArthur said, I shall return. I'm going back to the Philippines to help. After I retire and so forth. Thank you. Thank you so much. You know I'm in the South because I can smell biscuits and gravy and the hospitality here. So thank you. This is God's timing because when Karen and Bert Travis landed in the Philippines, it was just like this.
Amen.
So thank you. 45 years ago, God sent a special missionary couple to my life. Out of 7,100 islands in the Philippines, they chose, of all the islands, they chose Negros Island. And not only the Negros Island, there's a lot of town. They had chosen actually the little town called Talisay, my hometown, Millie's hometown as well. So thank you. And it's all in and all in God's providence. You know, can you imagine that? You know, flying from the comfort of Piquion, Mississippi, and all the way to you know, to Talisay. So thank you. And God bless you. Year 1974 is a very special year for me, and so with many, many high school students. It is so special because 1974 was the year I and hundreds of others received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior.
Amen.
There are just so many of us that received Christ in that year that one of the faculty members, quote, said, "You made a Baptist out of this school." That is a true story. I am so forever grateful to, for you, Brother Travis and Miss Karen, who was at that time was pregnant with that young man, Trey. You did fantastic, my brother, and I love you. She was pregnant, 6 months pregnant with Trey at that time. And her husband, as I said, they left Picky in Mississippi and went all the way there to share the good news of Jesus Christ. They introduced me to Jesus Christ. And of course, Dadai, Millie, Ibrado, you know, there, and her husband, and Brother Doyle and Miss Linda and many others, Brother Freeman, had actually discipled me all along the way. And so I'm forever thankful for them as well. In retrospect, I am forever thankful for Miss Karen introducing me, of course, to Jesus and also teaching me some songs. I'm not as good as Lamar, but I'm about to sing here, okay? Yes, I could have fooled the Southeastern Baptist College that I could sing. It was because of Miss Karen. But for you see, she taught us a lot of songs, Christian songs and Christian hymns. And one of my favorite songs that Karen taught us to sing was the song, I'll Tell the World That I Am a Christian. I had a chance of speaking to her and thanking her on 30 March 2019 through a Facebook post. And I said to her, quote, Miss Karen, thank you so much for your life of faithful service to God. Thank you so much for singing it again right here in this church on 22nd April 2018 when I requested it. Again, thank you for sharing that before I shared the message that morning at Chris Grove Baptist Church, Lacombe, Louisiana. That song, ladies and gentlemen, left an indelible mark in my Christian life to this very day. I try to follow the message of that song in my daily walk with Jesus. Miss Karen was singing the song. She always sing it from the heart. And you know that. She always sing it from the heart. I could still hear her singing the song, I'll tell the world that I'm a Christian. I'm not ashamed his name to bear. I'll tell the world that I'm a Christian. I'll take him with me anywhere. I'll tell the world how Jesus saved me.
Amen.
And how he gave me a life brand new. And I know that you, if you trust him, that all he gave me, he'll give to you. I'll tell the world that he's my savior. No one could love me so. My life, my all, in his forever. And where he leads me, I will go.
Amen.
Love. And then Brother Dondoy. And she literally followed that. Where he leads me, I will follow. Even following with the Lord, with Brother Travis, all the way to the island of the Philippines. Something interesting about Miss Karen. I do not know if you know, I told her sister today, that Karen is actually a Danish, Scandinavian name, meaning pure. And Trey was absolutely correct. He mentioned the word pure. Catherine, that's where the word came from as well. The word Kathy was my wife, from also from Mississippi, where also I met in church here in Mississippi. It means pure. And it also is a Hebrew word for Karen, K-E-R-E-N, which means glorious dignity or a ray of light.
Amen.
And that's what she was. She was always a ray of light for me and for the thousands of others wherever she goes. That's in the Bible. Karen is, of course, you might be interested to know, that is one of the daughters of Job. She has, Job had three daughters. Brother Birch and Mrs. Bort had three daughters. And Job named their daughters, of course, Karen, Jemima, and Keziah. Can you imagine if Brother Birch had actually followed the Bible completely? Their name would have been Karen, Jemima, and Keziah. But three unforgettable lessons I learned from Miss Karen, and these are the three. Miss Karen always demonstrated the real meaning of patience. Patient, very patient person. Miss Karen has heard and learned it from, of course, from her daddy, a Brother Birch, who was a preacher. She would have heard the word from the Bible which says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience. Kindness, goodness, and faithfulness, Galatians 5:22. She carried that special Christian virtue all along her life, including when she became a missionary. 45 years ago, going to Talisay, Miss Karen was always so patient with us, especially with, you know, with a bunch of teenagers, especially during the Sunday afternoon choir practice. Listen, Listen, not even one have I observed her getting mad to me or my fellow teenagers. Not even once, although we were kind of misbehaving ourselves at times. Not even one. She was so patient, and I don't know. I don't know about Brother Travis. If you ask him, he might know. But I do not know in any way in my entire life. When in fact, I'll have to stretch this a little bit farther. When in fact, not even one in the last 45 years that I observed her getting mad on something. Miss Karen is always a great example for all of us to follow in the Christian virtue of patience. Between Miss Karen and Brother Johnny Moore, I learned so much about the real meaning of patience. Brother Moore used to say, quote, "Brother Dondoy, I do not have to be a doctor to have a patient," unquote. Secondly, Miss Karen actually exemplified what I call honor, courage, and commitment. Her son Trey and thousands of others who have joined the Navy and the Marine Corps, the three words that we always remember: honor, courage, and commitment. Amen. Honor, courage, and commitment. Everything that Miss Karen did was to honor her Lord. Amen. With an unblemished integrity. Miss Karen was the most courageous person I know, fighting for her life against all odds. Amen. She fought the incurable cancer vigorously and staying alive way beyond the medical community predicted. They said, Brother Travis called me and said, the doctor said, maybe 2 weeks, 3 weeks, maybe two or three months, and that was 2 years ago. Yeah. I prayed, and you prayed, and everyone prayed. God answered prayer, and she was still with us for over 2 years. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, she was indeed a brave person. Your prayers sustained her. The loving support of her husband, Brother Travis, and all of her friends and children and grandchildren and all relatives and all of her friends keep her going. Once again, her fighting spirit never gave up. Amen. Only her frail body did. And of course, that's a great example of what I call Christian courage. Yes, honor. Yes, courage. But most of all, commitment. Commitment, Miss Karen, it epitomized of a life well lived of commitment. Miss Karen had a great commitment to her call as a missionary pastor, and she was totally committed to her children, and she was absolutely committed to her calling as a singer for God, starting with her mom and dad, and then as a member of the Birch Trio from Mississippi and Arkansas, and many other states, whatever, but at least that's the one I remember. The last one out of the list, I'm gonna take this off. Yeah, the last one out of the list, Miss Karen and Brother Travis taught me this verse, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And that's exactly what I did. I believe in Jesus Christ because of this lady right here, because of Miss Karen. Amen. Brother Doyle, thank you. Miss Linda, Brother Freeman, Dada, who discipled me, who was a Christian at that time already. And that's the verse that I will still never forget in my entire life. John 3:16 and Romans 5:8, of course, but God demonstrated his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, the love of God. Karen was committed to love people. He was committed a person. Yes, most of all, she demonstrated her love of God and her fellow man many, many times. All of you here and those who are watching in Facebook will agree with me that Miss Karen is indeed is a loving and a caring person. She demonstrated her love to you so many, many times. You know, she always made me feel as a family member. Just like Brother E. Moore said, that keeps telling me, you're not a friend, you're a family member. Indeed, when I come back here, it is, I feel like a family member to you. And so thank you. And this is how she demonstrated it to me of the love that she had for me. I know, Brother Travis, I know that you didn't like it, that I... You know, that the Lord had led me to come to the United States because I wanted to learn more, and I wanted to go to seminary and what have you. I know, but I know that God had the plan. This is kind of ironic. He was my pastor in the Philippines, but when I was in California, I became his pastor. And when I was in California, he started this church in California, and where he met Lamar. where he met you and many others. For 22 years, they were there in California. All right, so thank you. But this is how she demonstrated her love for me. I was, of course, a poor teenager, and you invited me into your house, for lunch, for dinner, and for breakfast too. All right? She introduced me to what we call the biscuit. You call it biscuit here. We call it biscuit. And I understand that it's better than pandesal as a Philippine bread, you know. So she and Myrna baked some of the most delicious desserts. She made me and introduced me to the sweetest iced tea of all. They call it the sweet tea. I would never blame her that the reason I have type 2 because of that sweet tea, you know, that you all are drinking. So thank you, Ms. Karen. When I was preparing for my departure from the Philippines in 1979, summer of 1979, I didn't have any dime in my pocket at all. She had the wisdom that she knew that one day I'll be hungry on the way to Piquion, Mississippi via San Francisco, well, actually Guam, Honolulu, San Francisco, and all the way to, you know, all the way here to Piquion and ultimately to New Orleans. And so whatever she had in her pocket, she went back to her bedroom and went to her purse. She did not have much, friends, she did not have much, but what she gave what she had, because she knew that along the way, I will get hungry. Yes, I was praying that I won't get hungry all the way, but by the time I reached San Francisco, I was so starving to death, and I was forever grateful for Miss Karen that she gave me this $12 in my pocket, and I was able to get those from the vending machine. That's, friend, not only that she cared, but she loved. That's what we call a total love. Compassion, we call it compassion. And that's why she won so many friends and so won so many people to the Lord, because of her compassion. She was quite a quiet person, and Brother Travis is the opposite, but she was there. She was there. But she was there. And she preached the gospel as effective as this guy did, all right, in her own way. Also, so I conclude that in my opinion, maybe I learned this, not only maybe, but I learned this on how to really give. The other day when my wife and I went to the Golden Corral, all you can eat Golden Corral in El Cajon, you know, California. When we went out there, there was a lady, you can see, she was homeless. She had a little dog, and then she was crying, and I have a food in my hand. God taught me that, and Miss Karen taught me that, whatever you have in your hand, share. And I share, and that's not enough. I said, you know, she's hungry, the dog was thirsty. We went back to the car, and we got more. And Kathy said, why don't you give her more? And we give her more. Friends, I learned that from the Lord, and I learned that from Miss Karen. Amen. To be giving, compassion, giving to others. Miss Karen and Brother Travis have known each other for 50 years. He described Karen's love for her family. Brother Travis posted a moving message on March 18, I don't know if you remember this, about his wife. This is just an excerpt of what that post. He said, now, quote, now after 50 years of loving and living life together, I sit beside her hospital bed in our bedroom with a life of memories which will soon be all I have left. No man ever had a more loving wife. No child ever had a more devoted mother. No grandchild ever had a more doting granny. No church ever had a more dedicated first lady. And then there's a parenthesis, she never did like it for me to call her dad, first lady. No company ever had more conscientious employee. She is simply one of a kind, unquote. Ladies and gentlemen, when I think of Miss Karen, I think of a very patient person, honorable, courageous, committed, and a loving Christian. Miss Karen is my hero in the faith. Amen. 50 years ago, two memorable events happened. You remember that? 50 years ago, Neil Armstrong, Buzz Aldrin, and Michael Collins landed and took pictures of the Earth from the moon. Second, 50 years ago, this lucky guy right here met Miss Karen. Miss Karen and Brother Travis Elmore met and fell in love in Laurel, Mississippi. Amen. That was 50 years ago, brother. Amen. This year. 50 years ago, the Apollo 11 astronaut gave us a unique view from the other side of the planet Earth. The photos of the blue planet are absolutely stunning. My brothers and sisters, as I gaze at the moon and all the stars around the night in Southern California, and then when I arrived here on my first night, Saturday night, I looked up at the sky, it was so clear, the stars. And then, of course, I marvel at the beauty of that God's creation, the moon and the stars and the millions of stars. A little girl marveled at what she saw at the stars at night one time, and then she said, quote, "If heaven is so beautiful from this side, heaven must be very beautiful on the other side." Amen. Friends, you have a lot of tears. There's a lot of joy on the other side of heaven. Amen. Here on earth is full of sorrow, heartaches, and pain. For more than 2 years, Miss Karen inspired all of us on how she faced pain caused by one of the rarest diseases known to the medical world, known as the PPC. Primary peritoneal cancer. She fought a great fight. She lost the battle against PCC, but she won the war against the pain. Amen. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. She did it all the way through. Here on earth is full of pain. The Bible says he'll wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death is gone for good. Tears gone. Crying gone. Pain gone. All the thirst. First order of the things gone. Death, sorrow, crying, pain, all of that has gone forever. And that is in Revelation 21 and verse 4. Heaven on this side is full. Heaven on the other side, of course, is full of joy. No more heartaches and no more pain. Here on earth, that heaven on earth is dark and dreary and humid and hot. You know, heaven on the other side is always sunny and full of life. Here on earth is turmoil and troubles all around. You probably all remember that there are troubles all around, all over the country, including what happened in Gilroy, California, just 2 days ago, that we lost at least 3 people and hurt other people. Then on this side, it is a painful separation. But however, Miss Karen's separation from all of us means a promotion and a grand reunion with the Heavenly Father in heaven. Amen. We all are crying here, but on the other side, she was rejoicing with Brother Bert, amen, with her mama, amen, with all the Christians, brothers and sisters, amen, who are all over there on the other side. Amen. The Bible promises the heaven for those who trusted in Jesus. Miss Karen wanted me to let you know that she had trusted and believed in Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. She wants you to do the same thing today. Amen. Today. Amen. Don't wait until tomorrow. Yeah. Don't wait until tomorrow. So that's one of the reasons why she had asked me, I understand, is to tell you that God loves you. That's how she told me in 1974, September 5th, 1974, that God loves me and has a wonderful plan for my life. And she told me, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know. And Jesus said, and Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know the way. And Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus, the parent, had found that way through Jesus Christ, because he is the way to heaven. Amen. In closing, Miss Karen today is in heaven. Once again, let me repeat, reuniting with her parents. Yes, you're crying here on this side. I saw a lot of tears from the beginning, from yesterday, and even before that, I'm sure. And today, I saw a lot of tears. But the Bible had said that there'll be no more tears. All the tears will be gone. I pray that today, that before we close here today, I'm going to pray a very similar prayer, that the missionary had prayed in 1974, and I want us to do that. All of you, who have never said a prayer, please say this prayer with me in your heart, or you can say it aloud, by just saying, Lord, I know that I am a sinner. I am sorry for my sins. I ask you to please forgive me of all of my sins. I believe in Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I believe he died for my sins, and that you raised him from the dead to life. Jesus, I know, please, I now place my trust, believe in you. I surrender my all to you right now. Please come into my heart and fill me with your Holy Spirit. The Bible promises that when I die, I will be with you forever and ever. Amen. I love all of you. Miss Karen, actually his father was in the army. He was an American hero who served in World War II. And so was Trey, was in the Marine Corps. And so it's just fitting. I know the flag is behind here, that I have to salute not only the flag, but her as well, for her service to our country. And I want to thank all of you for coming here today. And if you have received Christ as your Lord and Savior, please tell me, tell Brother Travis, or tell one of the ministers here today. Max Lucado said, God will carry you through. I have these books for all of you. I brought them all the way from California. You're going to have a copy. Thank you.
Amen. 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 Here. Everything's done at the cemetery. You make your way back to your cars. The books will be here. You can come by and pick up a book. Everybody knows Dundoy, right? Everybody say Dundoy.
Dundoy.
Now, in addition to Dundoy, there's also a Dadai. Everybody say Dadai.
Dadai.
Millie Brado. Now, I didn't think Dundoy should come to America. If he did, I was wrong. He was right. I thought Millie should come to America. She did. I was right. And she met Don Mackey. She became Millie Mackey. And like I got a lot of good friends, Karen had so many good, good, godly women friends. And Millie was, I don't guess the first, but one of the first, and one of the longest relationships. So Millie's going to come. Again, when Karen wrote her journal, it's right here. This is her funeral journal. The very first person she mentioned that she wanted to sing was Dada. And she had a particular song that she wanted her to sing. And she asked her a few months ago, and she said, of course. So Millie's going to come and sing and say anything she wants to say.
Miracles after miracles happened in my life, and one of those miracles, first one, was the Lord saved me, and the Lord led me to talk to the high school students in my high school. And then we didn't have a church, and so I asked God to somehow, you know, make it possible for my friends to have a church to go to. There was already a Baptist church there, but there was one in my hometown. And so Travis and Karen came. I'll never forget it. She was still pregnant. And Pastor Travis had these thick eyeglasses on. I've never seen anything like that before. And his eyes, I thought, were really, really small. But, you know, now he has contacts. So it's like a, you know, new age, whatever, improvements. And another miracle in my life was I didn't have a way to go to college. And there were 9 of us in the family. And so when it came to me, I was the youngest, and my parents couldn't afford to, you know, send me to school. And so I prayed and prayed. And Brother Travis and Karen were instrumental in allowing me to go to Liberty University. got my master's degree there, and I worked with them in Portland, Corpus Christi, where I met Don, and ever since then, I've been in the full-time ministry, and in any vocation that we're in, we're all full-time ministers. And I'm currently a school counselor, but I have an opportunity, it's a public school, that I have an opportunity to share the gospel with the kids that I deal with. And so, this song I'm going to sing to you, I don't think I knew it until Karen came, and she taught me the song. So.
Particularly good, and she said, "I want to see where I'm going to be buried." So I brought her here to Peace Grove and showed her the plot. And then she said, I want to go to Hobby Lobby. I want to pick out the material for the inside of my casket. And I took her to Hobby Lobby. And that was, I guess, the last good day she had outside. And that was when June, no, must have been May. I don't know, whenever it was a few weeks, months ago. In building the casket, I wanted something to go on top that would represent her life. And I found an image on the internet that had a cross and a treble clef. She loved Jesus more than anything else. And she loved to worship and praise Jesus. And I thought, that's the perfect emblem. And the man who made the emblem that's on the top of her cross gave me this yesterday. This is the board that it was cut out of. When she saw how the casket was going to turn out, I asked her one day, I said, what if I could get a horse and buggy to carry you from the church to the cemetery? She said, you mean like the president? I said, yeah, just like the president. And I tried and I tried and I could not find a horse and a buggy to do it. What was it, 2 weeks ago? I told Ron Patterson, and he said, well, I might. And then he went and talked to Jeff Usry. And Jeff Usry said, I know somebody. In fact, I know two somebodies. And guess what? We have a horse and a buckboard out there. The funeral director, who's been so kind, Mr. Jack, is going to come and help the pallbearers. And they're going to deliver the casket to the buckboard. And then we will all follow the buckboard out to the cemetery. And Karen's final request for her funeral service was that as we go there, we sing Amazing Grace. Don't worry if you don't sing good or whatever, or if you're off key, nobody's going to care. Just sing Amazing Grace. You don't have to sing with anybody else, just sing it by yourself if you want to. But we will sing Amazing Grace. Now let me say one more thing and then Jack is yours, okay? In this book, Karen has selected 16 songs to be sung at her funeral. We did six this morning. Sorry, darling. That would have been way too much. Okay, Jack, I'll move this out of your way. I said one more thing. Can I do one more thing? I'm looking, but I don't know. Are any of the hospice... Oh, I see Meredith back there. We have some hospice. Would you stand, please? Welcome, hospice care. Since the first day of March, these people have cared much for my dear wife.
Amen.
In ways I never would have been able to. They helped me learn how to care for her as well. And I cannot thank you enough.
Amen. For all of you. Amen.
And
our sister.
Trey asked me if we're going to do open mic. That was another request she had. We're not going to do this. Thank you.
Thank you, Brother Travis. Brother Dundoy, and everybody else for your contributions to this beautiful service in honor of a obviously very beautiful person. Momentarily, we are going to make our way to the cemetery right down the road. As Brother Travis said, we're going to be walking and singing Amazing Grace. We're going to take a few minutes to kind of clear our space here so that we can get Karen's casket this way. So I'm going to ask our pallbearers to gather over on this side and give us, if there's some others that can help us with these four flower, these standing sprays here, we're going to bring them to our funeral hearse, which is going to carry the flowers specifically, and then we'll make our way to the horse and buggy. And so before we go to our committal portion. Does anybody need to use the facilities or anything like that? That would be a good time at this time. We're going to just take a couple of minutes to get ready before we make our procession. Thank you. And I'm sure y'all realize that after the committal service, there is refreshments in Fellowship Hall to continue to be in faith and fellowship with the family. Thank you.
You don't have to stand up, Jake. Sit down. If you're hurting, okay?
Huh? Okay. I don't know.